Good time of day to all of you, my friends here on the Internet Chess Club. This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky. Welcome back to what every Russian schoolboy knows. Yeah, after this long talk about the Botvinnik system and all that, I would like to continue along the same lines, basically sharing my experience with various openings. As I kept expanding my opening repertoire. Yeah, I know there is certain question of how valuable this information is in terms of your opening preparation. Well, it's not really that. It's not like I'm revealing you some secret variations that you could immediately use in your practical games. It's never really been a purpose of this. It is more of sharing with you my approach to acquiring openings. And I already mentioned that I was a big proponent of, well, take it there and see how it works, and then study afterwards. Okay. Anyway, good or bad, this is the way I always been, and I guess I had some success with that approach. Anyway, to the King's Indian now. Yeah, to the King's Indian. So I wanted to play this opening. I always did, as I was a young player. Fortunately, there was no good example for me to follow. While the King's Indian obviously was a common opening, and many ideas already had been known since the 1950s, most of help I would get that I was able to get was mainly on the classical variation, and there were some others, obviously. And at that time, in the late 1970s and the 1980s, when I finally joined the party on the black side, while the classical was still popular, of course, the Martel Plata variation and all that. I had seen all those games. But a lot of people played a different approach. They like to keep the king in the center for white and keep and close it answering e5 with d5, particularly the Auerbach system. So, anyway, this is what I'm talking about here. So instead of this stuff, right? I mean, this type of position, well, I don't know. I wasn't quite sure if I really wanted to play it with black all the time. But at least if I did, I would have good examples to follow. Black's planes already had been known. But the Auerbach, caused particular problems. No, first of all, black doesn't want to blunder, right? E5 immediately likely is not a good idea because white has this move. You must go knight d7, and then, you're going to lose this pawn on c7, I suppose, for next to nothing. But I wanted to play e5. Obviously, I was aware of the move c5. And perhaps we'll talk about this maybe a little later in the second part. Because I got to it significantly later. Mainly when I started playing the Auerbach system with white. To that type of position, d5, and then either H6 or E6 immediately. But it's more Benoni like, right? And I wanted to play the King's Indian, understandable. So I wanted to get E5 in. And of course, I knew about this move, so you can play E5 next. But that's exactly what was happening over there. F3, and then what do? You're almost like on the black side of the Semish variation with F3. And the pin is annoying, and you can't really do anything about this bishop. And of course, white then sends forward to this G, and J and H pawns. Anyway, I was searching for something, and accidentally, I don't know, maybe I discovered it myself rather by accident, I'm not sure. I couldn't locate any game that would precede my idea. Anyway, H6 was known, of course, no big deal. Although white is happy to see that pawn on H6, of course. There is a queen d2 at tempo coming up on that pawn. And of course, when white sends the GnH pawns forward, he could take advantage of that weakening of the black king side. We'll talk about this, of course. But I mean the games, right? So here I am, like, looking at all this. Yeah, I could do this. Now what? I suppose I play king h7, right? So in comes g4. And I don't know. Now, what to do here? a5? To secure the knight. Why does this? I mean, one game. I mean, I saw very many. A game is not particularly interesting, or it's the game between Laszlo Szabo and Fredrik Olofsson, two of the best players of the 1950s. They played in 1954. Just look at this move, right? Rook h8. I didn't want to play this. I mean, white had all the freedom he could ask for. Look at this position. Black cannot even play c6 because he has problems after this. So the queen is underprotected. Even that is impossible. Not to mention that c6 may not be sufficient in generating any counterplay. And what did Olofsson do? He played that. Now this maneuver. The bishop. It's interesting that bishop gets to this diagonal while avoiding the d3 square. I kind of basically understood already that white doesn't want to trade any pieces. And the issue of that white square bishop, as I was there in my early 20s and my game improved, it was ambiguous to me. I couldn't really tell. Is it really such a bad piece? Maybe it's not. Because it kind of supports white's pawns, right? When the bishop was on e2, it was making b5 very difficult. Now the bishop is going to come to c2, as he did here. Then, of course, f5 is always just out of the question. Black will never get f5. Oh, I don't know if I should be wasting too much time. He went knight to h3, That knight was on e8, stepping away from e5. I suppose maybe the only trade that White didn't mind, Szabo, was to get rid of that knight on c5. But already, like with this rook on h8, king on g8. In case you wonder how black how white breaks through, I will continue with this, showing you this game. Very deliberate preparation, of course, and white can do anything he wants. So finally, Olofsson moved the pawn forward. I suppose white was going to play pawn to g5 anyway. And now, in two moves, white switches to play an f4. So we like thinking, like, in generally speaking, f4, right? F4 in the King's Indian, this move after the trade will open up that bishop from g7, maybe give the black knight e5 square. But as black's pieces they drift away, then f4, like in this game, it just becomes completely crushing. Bishop f8 he played, and then f4. Horrible. And what did Szabo do here? Of course, he plays his bishop in the middle. And finally, this knight. I guess that knight was coming to e3 and then f5 eventually with the decisive attack. So Olofsson traded. Tripled up now. No, this move speaks volumes of how hopelessly passive black's position was. And, there it comes. As the bad bishop finally enters the stage, it's going to play the critical role in it. Queen e7, he pulled the bishop back. Last two moves. Rook g7. No, right, yeah, white is not interested in winning the exchange. Instead came the crushing blow. Yeah, if you look at this game, and there are many games of similar kind, you realize where the problem is. I mean, King's Indian is supposed to be the opening where you take risks, but you attack. You got chances. But how to generate chances against this Averbach setup? I really had no idea as I was looking at these games. And there was a certain period of when I wanted to play the King's Indian, but every time I thought, what would I do if they played the Averbach? Well, I had a friend at that time who would also become a grandmaster. And he was a career King's Indian player. And he was trying some things, which I liked, some of them, some I didn't like. But anyway, even with his help, I still couldn't get over the hump in dealing with this. And finally, after some long deliberations, I came up with this idea. All right, look at this position on the board. So instead of king h7, which allows white to play g4, black takes his last chance to do something about this positional threat of g4. Plays the knight to h5. All right, so first off, the pawn. The pawn is actually taboo because black now has this check. I mean, I can play here. I'm not even sure if black should necessarily go after the exchange. This is okay. Obviously, the queen is not going to get trapped. But maybe even more energetic would be just to play f5. It's hard for white to deal with the threat of knight g3, and there's pressure and attack against e4. On the other hand, if we go this way, then very good for black is this move. Queen f2, hitting the pawn on g2, that is, well, pretty difficult to protect. You don't have this move because there is no good recapture. One of the bishops, either that one or that one, is going to be lost. So, but that wasn't really that difficult. Obviously, knight h5 is just one move. So, first time around when I played that, my opponent was a very experienced player, older than me, much more accomplished, from Soviet Georgia, Elisbar Ubilava. Later, Elisbar moved to Spain, has been living in Spain for a long time. He worked with Anand for many years. Recently, I was happy to meet Elisbar Ubilava again in Khantymansk, where we both were invited to work as commentators. I did the English channel, he did the Spanish channel together with Leoncio Garcia. Yeah, we had a lot of talks. He was a good player. We played quite a bit. So he castles, and now I play king h7. So what changed? No, one thing changed. If white pushes forward with this move, black, of course, is going to put that knight on f4. Now, in itself, this kind of pawn sacrifice, it's a known idea. It's all about removing the pawn from e5 and opening up the dark square bishop on g7, particularly in situations where white parts with his own dark square bishop. So there wasn't anything revolutionary about this. But all the same, if the white played this move g3, the big question is, to that knight on h5. Because suppose black plays f5, right? Then white takes, is supposed to take with the pawn. And now the knight on h5 is loose. And there is like this possibility. You can't even get to attack this bishop because the bishop always has the tempo capture on c5. And then the h5 knight is lost. Now, of course, this is not any better because everything's falling apart. So, the biggest question to my idea, which is, it's a game from 1981. I was 23 years old and just was making my entrance into Soviet Union national chess scene. And honestly, I didn't have the openings to do this. So the biggest question to me was, what is black going to do? Again, c6 is hard to accomplish, right? Because of this issue with capture on c6. I either lose the pawn on d6 or even may lose the knight. And generally speaking, suppose if I played c6, do I really want to take on d5? maybe in the absence of the black knight from f6, white can capture with the knight on d5. So anyway, all these things, they were questionable, but bishop d7. Now, so Belava uses the same maneuver that Szabo did against Tollefsen. He repositions his bishop to c2. The reason why it wants to do this is the issue of the knight on g1, so it has to go. And besides, to complement its pawn formation, which essentially is from the same-ish variation with f3, they need to place the knight to e2. And furthermore, once that knight comes to e2, as it happened in a few moves, white begins to think in earnest about pushing that pawn to g4, because now they can win the pawn in reply to knight f4 without giving up the dark square bishop. So I did what? I played a3. So this was my idea, basically. So drive the a pawn forward, force this, then bring this knight to b4. And create this situation around the white king where any kind of opening of the center, or rather the diagonals looking at the white king, could give black excellent chances. Now, another thing, of course, that once the knight is on b4, maybe black can return to some plans of moving the c-pawn forward. Okay, this first time around, I'm not sure I played it best way, but my opponent played knight b5 very alertly, so he didn't give me a chance to take the b4 square. And again, it slowed down my c-pawn because of the problems with my pawn on d6. I did go f5 now. I don't know. I thought this capture, obviously, this is what they want. The position of the king on h7 is not great at all. I'm not sure I like this queen on a7 either, because look, it's against the white rook on a1. So it may give white some additional tactical possibility. But of course, still, you know, I'm looking to play this. Imagine if this whole thing happens and I get to come to this diagonal. Dreams come true. He played a careful move here, and objectively speaking, I made notes after the game. I absolutely had to go f4. I didn't want to release this tension. It's not like I was afraid of this. Even if white wisely will refrain from taking on f4, of course, and they'll play that. I mean, after bishop e5, I keep white from moving that e-pawn forward. Remember how the Szabo Olofsson ended with that bishop coming to life and hitting g6. Of course, this has to be stopped. So this would be a playable position. So f4 was the right move. I think on white's problem is that on bishop g1 leads to this inconvenient situation when the rook has to block the bishop, and here, who knows, maybe there is c6. Even as a pawn sacrifice and the awkward white pieces, it may work. For example, it's visible here, right? So you do this, and then comes that, and you don't really have c5 because your bishop is blocked, right? So But I didn't play this. I played knight f6, so it probably would cost me dearly if my opponent went for this. But I was lucky. He hesitated for one move, and we made some trades, and I actually achieved a playable position. Well, there are two factors in this. First off, black can exchange some pieces, so that typical problems with playing the King's Indian, where you suffocate, you don't have space for your pieces. It's no longer an issue, right? And white never got to get anything going against the black king. The bishop pair and the... Yeah, but it's probably short-lived, because I already saw how I'm going to engineer a trade of dark square bishops. And, there were some tactical issues, like, obviously, white wanted to play b4, but he needed preparation because of the black queen invasion. This was a good move, not to surrender the f-file. But the white queen that is needed there to hit the pawn on c7 or maybe collect the pawn on a3, the pawns, well, is now busy with the defensive task. Not a bad play from my opponent. He kept control of everything, but I managed to trade those bishops. So as the white king went to collect my pawn, obviously long term, if the a3 pawn is lost and the a pawn starts moving forward, then white will win the game. But counterplay came just in time. So that loosening of white's queenside accomplished by the suicidal run of the a pawn, well, it bore some fruit because black was able to generate some threats against the king. There are not enough to win the game, but they're enough to give perpetual check. There is nowhere to go with the king. So it was a good fighting draw, and the game that made me believe that maybe I can deal with the Auerbach. Although, well, there are still many things to do, many questions to answer. So, to round this up, I'll remind you once again that I'm not giving you the latest theoretical recommendations. Well, at least where I'm starting, you know, those games that go back, well, 40 years ago. So, but I hope you find this material enjoyable. So I fully intend to go on and tell you more about Auerbach King's Indian. And the games that I had in the system. Thank you for your attention. This was Grandmaster Alex Shermalinsky. Whatever Russian schoolboy.